So, Yukawa Meson theory usually talks about the nuclear force, and since we studied particle physics and we have a brief idea of what are mesons, okay, pi plus, pi minus, and pi naught, right? And what are the names given to them? Pi plus, pi minus, pi naught, charge and all, we know is basically a triplet state. We basically call them as pi mesons or pions, right? So we have these elementary particles involved in Yukawa Meson theory. So it very much makes sense that we can actually understand this fact, okay? So there has been a lot of theories which has been proposed when people talked about the strong force that exists in case of nucleons, right? Then people said that, okay, the gravitational force is weak, the electromagnetic force is weak, but the nuclear force is the strongest. Okay? The point here is what holds them together is the idea that we are exactly going to learn. Okay, so if before we start, let's imagine this. You are basically, let's say, playing a badminton, right? You are on two sides of the court, okay? And there is some restrictions involved. What is that restriction? You cannot cross the net and come on the other side, okay? You obviously cannot collide with any other person. If you're playing doubles, you cannot collide even with your partner, okay? So there is a kind of invisible shield that is created. So there is no such force as such. You can go to the other side, but you are not going there. What is the reason? Because you have got an invisible shield, an invisible force which is actually covering you up, okay? And that's the reason that you have limitations to it. Okay, you hit the ball or hit the shuttle too hard, it goes out of the court, the other person won't even attempt. Okay, so there is always some kind of restrictions that is involved. So it's similarly, if you are considering any kind of subatomic particles, there again there are some kind of restrictions. Okay, it's not that I will have the neutron and the neutron or the proton or the neutron proton very close, okay, and still there will be nuclear force. No. The nuclear force has got some kind of limitation. It acts only within a range. So we already know what is the higher order, right? We'd say, usually say that it can act only inside the nucleon, which has got a dimension of 10 to the power minus 10 meter. Sorry, 15 meter, femtometer, 10 to the power minus 15 meter. But then there is some restrictions that that's the upper limit, right? But there is also a lower limit. What does it mean? That it cannot come very close to each other for the nuclear force to work. Okay? If it comes very close to each other, there is a kind of repulsion that happens. Okay? And in case of a repulsive force, okay, what's the symbol or the sign in front of force? Is it positive or negative? Repulsive. What about attractive? Attractive is negative, right? And repulsive is basically positive. So if you basically plot a potential diagram, okay, potential diagram, we'll basically have a plot where the negative part shows the attractive force and the positive part will show the repulsive force. Okay. Now, this idea that neutron and proton are there is a continuous exchange of particle because of which we have the force involved, which is called the nuclear force. Just like we have the idea of photon and graviton and so on. But these mesons are actually detected. So mesons are continuously getting exchanged between proton, neutron. And that's the reason that they are bound together. Okay? So you are playing and you are in a professional match. The person is doing the service. Okay? You cannot move out of the court, right? All of a sudden. Because you are a professional, right? You are bound to play it. Okay? You cannot move out of the court. So you are bound to do that. Okay? So what happens is, if that exchange of these elementary particles is happening, the attraction is always there. There is some kind of binding. Okay? Binding nature. So that is what we are going to discuss in this Yukawa Meson theory. Okay? So this theory was given by Yukawa. Okay? And then we are going to see a lot of... It does also have some specific names to it. Okay? So this is also called exchange of particle theory. Okay? Exchange of particle theory.
Exchange of particle theory.
So let's imagine two protons, okay? So we have got two protons.
okay, and let's say they are separated by a distance of 1 femtometer.
So once they are separated by a distance of 1 femtometer and they are positive in nature, what I am expecting, there should be some Coulomb force. Nuclear force will come to that later. There should be some Coulomb force because both are positive and they are going to repel each other, right? So what will be the approximate force? 1 femtometer is atomic skin, right? 10 to the power minus 15 meter. So what is the force with which they are going to repel? So the Coulombic force would be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into E square divided by R. Right? Okay. So we can put the value of 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, 9 into 10 to the power 9. We can take the charge of proton, okay, 1.6 and all, so on, okay. And then we have got the this distance, which is nothing but 1 femtometer. Right? So if you put those values, the value that we are approximately going to get is 230 newton. Okay? Approximately 230 newton. Now the question is, if this is a large, is this a large force? How do you realize practically what is 230 newton? How do I realize it practically? You take a stone and imagine it's 23 kgs. You pull it. You hold it here. It's going to experience a gravitational pull, right? That is the weight. And gravitational pull means 9.8. So 10 lelo. So 23 to 10, 230 newton. So imagine those water barrels we have, 20 liters water barrel, okay? Other day I got hold of Sandeep to help me to take it to my room, okay? Wo kitne ka hai? 20 liter ka hai. Usko uthana itna mushkil hai. So can you imagine 230 newton means it's because I am experiencing a force of 200 newton. It's quite heavy, right? So that means this force is enormous. 230 newton chota force nahi hai, bahut bada force hai. Practically if you realize it, okay? Carrying a 23 kg stone, okay? So that's that. So this is basically a large force, okay? If they repel by this force, okay, if they repel by this force, they listen to this lecture carefully. At the end of the day, at the end of this lecture, I'm going to give you a tip about your answer, okay? So stand by. Okay. So if they repel by this force, how can they hold together, okay? How can they hold together inside the nucleus? That's my question. So this is because of the nuclear force. This is answer is because of nuclear force. We're just building up the story, okay? Because of nuclear force. So if this nuclear force you basically calculate, okay, using the equations and all everything, okay, this nuclear force comes out to be 25,000 newton. 25,000 newton, ठीक है? मतलब 2500 के जी उठाना है, गाड़ी उठाना पड़ेगा ऐसे चलिए, आपके कंट्री So 25,000 newton, okay, so much larger than this, okay. So there is a Coulomb repulsion, and if you consider the percentage, obviously there is some percent involved, but obviously the nuclear force is much more. And this nuclear force is basically charge independent, right? I have not discussed that. It is also there in your syllabus, but let's skip that, okay, we don't have time. Charge independent right now, there is a proof for that also. So nuclear forces are charge independent. So if they are charge independent, this is the force which is acting between proton, proton, neutron, 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 proton and so on. Nothing to do with the charges. Okay? So if you consider this case, this is something which is getting overcome. Okay? So that is important. Now let's talk about the nuclear force being repulsive and attractive. Okay? So let's write down a few points here. So we have the nuclear force. Okay? It can be repulsive, attractive. And it depends on what? It depends on distance. It can't depend on charge because it's charge independent. So it depends on distance. How far it is. Depends on distance. So what happens is if it is less than 0.8 femtometer, Now here comes the lower limit, the restrictions there, okay. So we have a range of 1 femtometer, and if it is less than 0.8 femtometer, means if these two protons are coming closer to each other, it becomes repulsive. And if this is, let's say, 0.8 to 2 femtometer, it is usually attractive. What about greater than 2 femtometer? Negligible. We don't have a nuclear force there, okay? The Coulomb force overtakes. And if I may just draw this diagram. So this is the potential diagram. I think we have drawn it numerous times. This is the force. So this is, let's say, is 0. It goes in this direction. So let's say this is 0.8. And let's say the unit is femtometer. Okay. And then we have got different ranges, and then we definitely have up to two, let's say somewhere here. Let's say it is 2 here. And then as it goes further and further, this is going to get negligible. It's going to get almost 0. So this is exactly what I mean by this. Okay. So this is the region where it is repulsive. Let's say this is the region where it is attractive, okay? And beyond this, this is negligible. And this graph we have come across a number of times, even when we studied shell models and all, okay? So potential diagrams and force diagrams more or less correlate with each other because F is equal to minus of dV by dr. Other points, so this Fn, that's the nuclear force, acts between proton, proton, neutron, neutron, proton, neutron. So Yukawa actually has given this theory, Hideki Yukawa, Japan, 1935, okay. When we are talking about these forces, let me just tell you one more thing here. Less than 0.8, it becomes repulsive. So imagine this, the other side, and you are coming very close to the net. You cannot play anymore, right? Racket lagega, theek hai? Net hi toot jayega, sab net pe aa rahe, theek hai? Not possible. You are taking a ball and you want to play catch, then also you cannot come too close, right? You cannot play it. So that's the thing that's happening here, okay? Although this is a very lame example, but let's try to understand the fact that happens. Aise likhna mat tha paper mein, main mark kar dunga. Ye samajhne ke liye.
Haan,
badminton khel rahe example mat dikha. So this theory was given by Hideki Yukawa. That's why it's Yukawa theory, 1935. So what he said was, so he said that nuclear force exists because of exchange of particles. So if there are exchange of particles, the nuclear force will exist, okay? So if you are bound within the badminton court, the particle is nothing but the shuttle. Shuttle is there, na? Shuttle hoga nahi to court ke baar chale jaoge, keep kar doge, right?
So what happens is this neutron or proton continuously emits or absorbs these particles, okay? Now what are these particles?
Mesons.
Okay? So these are nothing but pi mesons.
Not the other mesons,
pi mesons. Tell you why, because it was experimentally detected. Not exactly they knew that it was pi meson, but some results showed that pi meson in the experimental detection of these exchange of particles were similar. Okay. So the exchange particles are, might be like, I can write down one more line, because if you explain it in your exam, please explain it in such a way as if I know nothing, okay? You are supposed to explain it to me. Jaise aap मेरे फर्स्ट सेमेस्टर वाले ये करते हैं, उनको एज्यूम लगता है सर को तो पता है क्या लिखना है, शॉर्ट में लिख देंगे, ठीक है? मेरे को नहीं पता है, तुम लोग को बताना है कि तुम लोगों को पता है. द एक्सचेंज ऑफ पार्टिकल्स और द एक्सचेंज्ड पार्टिकल्स पाई प्लस पाई माइनस. ओके, आज तो चिल्ड्रंस डे है ना, हैप्पी चिल्ड्रंस डे.
थैंक यू सर.
14 नवंबर 2019 मेरे बच्चों का लास्ट क्लास है, इनके बारे में बोल रहा हूँ.
सो यू प्रॉमिस दैट यू यू ऑल विल डू समथिंग.
नो, आई एम फीलिंग सो गिल्टी अबाउट इट बिकॉज़ मॉर्निंग टाइम वी वर डिस्कसिंग विद जिंगली में, पता नहीं वजह से एग्जाम भी है, कुछ तो करना चाहिए ना.
यस सर.
होता है कि नहीं तो वी कैन सेलिब्रेट इट आफ्टर एग्जाम.
Sir, the feeling will not come.
Emotion chala jayega.
Yes, sir. So already we are becoming lesser and lesser children. So again, that time also will be.
Seriously. Acha chalo, class khatam karke fir discuss karenge isko. Sab jaake abhi. Okay, so what we have is this proton will disintegrate into pi plus plus neutron. Or we have got the neutron into pi plus into proton. Next question. Now what is the problem here? What is the problem here? The problem is not really. Let's not look into the conservation part, okay? What I am saying is I have got a proton and I have got a neutron. Okay? Or let's say this is a neutron and it emits pion, okay, and that pion goes into the proton. So, and then again the proton emits a pion, it goes into the neutron, continuous exchange is going on. Then if something is coming out of the neutron or coming out of the proton, it should lose some mass, right? But as per theory or whatever results we have or whatever data we have experimentally as well, the mass of proton and neutron are not fluctuating, they are the same. So if they are the same, then how can we have some particles getting exchanged between them? Does it make sense? You have that ball. When you have the ball with you, the entire mass is different. When you throw the ball, your mass reduces, right? Herein comes quantum mechanics to help. Okay? So that's why nuclear physics, quantum mechanics, atomic physics, somewhere connected. Okay? So we're not going to go into the deep details of quantum mechanics because your syllabus says it's only the basic theory. Okay? But what happens is this. So we have, let's say, a neutron on this side, and then let's say it emits pi plus, and then this side also, let's say we have got a neutron. Okay, so it will be a neutron-neutron interaction. Okay, so it might be pi plus, pi minus, and so on. Let me just take it in general. Okay, so if there is this and this is emitting, if this is emitting pi plus, what will be its mass? Mn minus m pi. Right, this should be the mass because a pion has come out of it, so this should be the mass. Okay, but then there was a problem. Okay, so if pi plus is emitted, resultant mass is mn minus m pi plus, right? So, but experimentally it was not observed, okay? Experimentally, fluctuating mass, obviously fluctuating, right? Fluctuating mass of neutron, proton was not observed. So whatever Yukawa said, yes,
okay, let's take this true. But this experimentally, it was not observed based on this problem, okay?
Now what happened was Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle came into the rescue, okay? Uncertainty
principle.
What does it say in general?
Forget about momentum and position cannot be determined at the same time, okay? Even in a more layman's language, whatever calculations or whatever predictions we are making cannot be accurate, okay? It has got its limitation, okay?
So that's the idea. So all measurements has limitations. All measurements has limitations. Next.
So this is possible, means exchange of pions, okay? But what will be the answer? This exchange is possible, but based on Heisenberg's uncertainty principle that all measurements has limitation, this cannot be detected, okay? It cannot be detected, okay, that's the problem, okay?
So exchange of pions is possible but cannot be detected. So what exactly it means that when this pi plus is absorbed or emitted, okay, emitted or absorbed, what is going to happen? There will be transfer of energy, right? Absorbed, transfer of energy takes place in a very short time, correct?
Yes.
What will be that speed at which the transfer of energy is taking place?
Light.
Speed of light, c, right? Mm. That's why it's relativistic in nature. Next, when we take it in a very short time, so I'm taking time, I'm taking energy.
So Heisenberg's uncertainty principle about energy and time, correct? Comes logical, right?
Because these are all related with each other. Del E del T should be greater than or equal to H cross divided by 2.
Correct?
Okay. So if we just look into it mathematically, that's exactly what's going to happen. So how much distance does the pion travel? So let's say this is N and this is N and this is the distance that the pion has to travel after it gets emitted. And let's say this is 1.7 femtometer, okay, some random value, but like it's okay because we know at that limit we have the exchange, okay, nuclear force at x attractive. What is the speed?
C.
So I'll just consider it to be the speed of light, very fast, okay, we have that. And then what will be the time? Time would be nothing but let's say this is L, right, L by C, correct? Time is L by C, distance by velocity, right? So if we take that, let's just estimate, okay, estimation. Now this is just an estimation, okay, cannot be an exact value, or might be different books will take different values, but somehow more or less the range is same. So del E, del T, let's omit this 2, let's say it's H cross. Let's find out what is this estimated value, okay. So if we take this, this energy is nothing but mc square, okay, And here we are concerned about finding out the mass of pion. So mc plus pi square. Okay. Let's just take m pi c square into delta t. So into delta t. Delta t is 1.7 is the length that it traverses divided by c. Okay. And then this 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 15 and so on. You can do these things, okay? 10 to the power minus 15 and all. And always do these calculations here, okay? So what we have here is nothing but m pi mass. And I've just done it directly. I hope it's correct. H cross divided by c into c square and c is there, right? So this and this will get cancelled. So this is h cross by c into 1 divided by 1.7 into 10 to the power minus 15. So what is Planck's constant? 6.6 into 10 to the power minus
34.
4 joules second, right? Yes. So that's joule, this is meter per second and so on. So we can put all the values. And approximately the value that we are getting is 2 into 10 to the power minus 28 kg. Right? If you do this calculation, we are going to get a value of 2 into 10 to the power minus 28 kg. We have got some figure in our hands. Let's see if we can analyze that. Okay. So we already know what is the mass of, let's say, electron, right? So if you compare it into mass of electron, so in comparison to mass of electron, in comparison to mass of electron, this mass of pion is nothing but approximately 220 mass of electron. 220 times the mass of electrons. Just 220. Okay, because mass of electron is 10 to the power minus 31 kg, right? That's already low. When you consider proton and neutron, it is 10 to the power minus 27 kg, okay? And you've got a one order difference. At this range, this one order difference makes a lot of sense, okay? So it's very, very difficult to detect that mass, okay? But then how people exactly found out, okay? So what happened a decade later, maybe in the 1950s, okay? After the theory has been given, okay? 1940s, 1950s. It was experimentally observed that certain particles were detected. Experimentally observed, okay? That certain particles were detected whose mass was 273 times the mass of electron, which is in this range, okay? And this actually has proved Yukawa's Meson theory. Where did that particle came from? People thought of a lot of explanation and people finally realized that no, the Yukawa theory, what was predicted, has to be this, okay? Because if we can prove that, okay, this can be mass of something else, then you are going to go for the next Nobel Prize, okay? So to understand that this was the theory, and this theory was in, you can say, in consonance with whatever we observed experimentally. Okay, so these were matching. So we have this, and then one more particle was detected, and 264 mu. And these experiments are usually quite accurate. Okay, so we have these values. So these pions are basically unstable. Okay. And then they decay. When does an elementary particle decay? When does an elementary particle usually decay? What do you think? When? Huh? Louder.
It is not stable.
Okay. That's actually the right answer. But even if we make it more simpler, anything will remain in that state if it's stable, right? And when does it become unstable? When it becomes free from a system. So what happens is these pions which we are talking about, when it comes out of the system, it is not bound to anything, it is unstable in nature, okay? And then it has to decay to go into a stable state, right? So this is what is happening there in this case, okay? So what happens is these charged pions will decay, okay? Charged pion decay. And if we have take this reaction, this time, average time in which it decays is 2.6 into 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. So what is this T? This is nothing but the lifetime, okay? The lifetime, okay? So it will decay in this time. So we can consider this as mean lifetime. You remember mean lifetime, half life and all? Lambda and all, okay?
This is basically the same thing, okay? The concept remains the same here. So we have this. So what happens is this pi plus will become mu plus plus muon neutrino, okay? And this pi minus, even if we do a verification of the conservation of quantum numbers here, then this should work, okay? And what about neutral pion decay? So in neutral pion decay, this lifetime is much more. Sorry, less. I mean, it decays even faster. Okay, seconds. Okay, these are the seconds. And this pi zero will decay into radiations.